Well, I got my start kind of in my current profession a long time ago. In the late 70s, I worked at a hardware store when I was in high school. And I learned so much in that hardware store. I took inventory, and people would come in with questions, and I learned essentially what was available just by asking my bosses, what is this? And he would tell me what it is, and then we'd go find it on the shelf, and I learned every piece and part in the hardware store during those couple of years. And that kind of got me a little bit more interested, and then when I moved to Colorado, I became a carpenter and built some houses of my own and remodeled some commercial buildings and worked for lots of different contractors over the years. But about 4 years ago, I was sitting in the City of Fort Collins Green Building Code classes, and I'd always been interested in more sustainable, better ways to build our houses, but the straw bales and the airships, I didn't really like them. I didn't like the style. I didn't like the process of building straw bales or airships. So I kept kind of just my job building traditional homes. But after I sat in these green building code classes, I realized that even though we were talking about green building and we were building our houses more energy efficient, in the process, we were actually using more chemical and oil-based products to try to make our homes more green. I thought there must be a better way. There must be a more natural way to build our houses. And in fact, we've been building structures since the beginning of time. There must have been a better way. So I got on the internet and I did a little searching around, and I found Hemp Lime Construction, a building course that was offered by a man from Ireland that was going to be in the United States. So I got on the airplane and went out there to take his workshop. And in 3 days, I learned the basics of the system that I'll share with you in a little bit, about how we use hemp and lime to build a thermal wall system. My history with industrial hemp goes back a little bit further. When I was about this age, here on the right, that's me in Springfield, Illinois, is where I grew up, not too far from Normal, Illinois, where there was at one point in time, an industrial hemp processing facility. And we would go over to see my uncle, and he had a 5-acre ranchette type of thing, and we'd ride his Shetland ponies and had a really good time. Now, one day we showed up and there was a whole bunch of police, and they had their lights on and they were cutting down a plant and they were burning this plant. And my family was a little, they didn't really understand it. They said at the time that it was marijuana, but even back then we knew that we used industrial hemp for ropes and sails and things like that. And so we knew that it wasn't a psychoactive substance at that point, but for some reason the police decided that they needed to burn it right out in front of his house. And that left a lasting impression on me. I kind of forgot that memory until I got a little bit more into industrial hemp. So that's a little bit about my history. The history of industrial hemp goes way back. And before 1937, all the way back into the early 1700s, we were deriving our food, clothing, energy, medicine, income, and shelter all from industrial hemp. And in fact, when I was out in Pennsylvania teaching a workshop, I met the author of this book, Les Stark. And he chronicled a book just in one particular county in Pennsylvania. Every farmer in this county was a hemp farmer. And he was able to pull from the wills what they would have. So I just, any page here I can turn off, and Rudolf Hunsacker will leave his second son and his mother a yearly quarter acre of hemp. or they might leave their daughter 20 pounds total of hackled hemp. And these are some of the stones that these were used. This here is a water mill where these big, huge, heavy stones would crush down the hemp and make it into different products for them. So this is the turn of the century, one particular county, and we're pretty sure that most of the entire eastern seaboard was comprised of hemp farmers. That's how they made their sails, that's how they made their ropes, that's how they got back and forth over to the other side of the pond. This is a hemp home that was used as a processing facility in Kentucky. And when the Kentucky industrial hemp movement came around later on in the early 1800s, it really did put a hamper on the Pennsylvania hemp industry because Kentucky and Tennessee started growing industrial hemp. Nowadays, we know that we have lots of industrial applications of hemp. And as technology increases and more universities get involved in the research and development of it, we know that there are lots of uses for the seed. It is very good for us. It's high in the omega-3s, 6s, and 9 oils. It's a high in protein. It's used for paints and sealants and has for quite a long time. The herd is the inside part of the stalk, normally used as a waste product. But nowadays we know that we can use it for all sorts of things, and is one of the primary things that we're developing with the building materials is the inner part of the stalk. And then the outer part of the stalk is a long fiber. So the shirt I have on right now is made out of industrial hemp. And in fact, it's the longest fiber that we know of, the natural fiber. Cotton is a short little fiber, and then it's weaved together to make a long string, where industrial hemp can be up to 12 to 15 feet long with one single strand of fiber. Typically our homes, I'm a carpenter by trade, so there's all kinds of things in industrial hemp, but I kind of focus on the building material side of it. And right now we build our buildings in Colorado, and as I travel around the world, it's different things, but we build them out of this OSB, the oriented strand board. It is our floor system, our subfloor, it's our walls, it's the sub roofing before we put our metal or our shingles on, pretty much everything. Even some of the beams and things like that are made out of a similar technology as oriented strand board. And when I first started building with oriented strand board, I thought, oh man, this is great. We're using wood chips that they've recycled. Boy, that's going to save the planet, right? But then when I got to researching it, I figured out that they don't use any recycled material in OSB. They take live trees, then chop them down, and then they have to go through a super drying process in order to get them dry enough to be able to use as the oriented strands. So much for saving trees building our houses. And even the other thing is some of this building materials, you notice, you know, some of it's even coming from China. So sometimes we're shipping most of our houses from over across the pond, and we ought to keep that more local. And if we can save some trees in the process, that's great. Also, the more we started sealing up our homes, we were using caulk and more paints and oil-based paints, but even water-based paints have lots of chemicals in them to keep them from off-gassing too much. A lot of our stuff is shipped from China that goes into our homes nowadays, which leads to a high embodied energy for the actual building of the structure. Industrial hemp is more eco-friendly because we're able to actually grow a good size crop in one season, equal to more than what you would get from a similar stand of trees as far as the resource. And it's easier to process than trees into different materials. So we get a little bit more into hemp for homes. This is the first example of a home that was built using industrial hemp. So we can make them pretty much any style, make them look any way that we want to. The more typical way to finish it is with an exterior plaster. This particular system that I'm going to talk about is a very comfortable, easy to maintain, earth-friendly way to build a structure. Here's some of the advantages here. When I was out taking that workshop out in Wisconsin, I left on a Saturday morning and I looked up into the mountains, and it was about June 5th, and I saw a plume of smoke. And there hadn't been any fires reported yet this year in the mountains. And by the time I got to Wisconsin, I'd just gotten my iPhone. I hadn't had a smartphone before yet, and I'm glad I had it because I watched from Wisconsin, our forest, our backyard, 70,000 acres burned down by the time that fire was over. So one of my first questions to Steve was, is it fire resistant? And he He says, oh, he's from Ireland. Oh, John, you could hardly burn it if you tried. And he sent me to a video where he's got a fire test online where he holds a torch up to it. And because of the way the recipe works, it is extremely fire resistant. And essentially a non-combustible material, which means it doesn't start other stuff on fire. Also because of the way that the system works, pests, termites, things like that don't like it. Number two on this list here, vapor permeable or breathable. For so long, we've been convinced that we ought to seal our homes up. We have Tyvek or house wrap, we have caulk, we have paint, we have vapor barriers, all this type of thing. But then as a remodeling carpenter, I know that if a little bit of moisture gets inside of that sealed system, it really does cause damage to the insulating material, but also to the framing members themselves. Where this system actually allows the entire structure not to let air infiltration in, but to let a little bit of moisture into its walls, which leads to less mold and mildew and things like that. One of the most famous hemp homes in the United States, there's literally thousands of these have been built in Europe, and that's where we get most of our expertise and our information. But here's one that was built by the former mayor of Asheville, North Carolina. This was built maybe 10 years ago now, and he had a good budget, and he built it, you know, fairly modern and fairly fancy. Here's some other examples of some hemp homes. This one is also, there happens to be two in Asheville. This one you can actually rent. You can actually stay in it as a bed and breakfast if you want to. The Nah House is what it's called. When I was over, I got invited to teach about hemp building over in Poland, believe it or not. I went all the way across the pond to teach in Poland. And when I was over there, I met a gentleman that was doing some hemp building in the Ukraine. And he does some domes like you see here. Hempire is the name of Sergei's company. And here is some examples of hemp homes. This is a hemp tiny home that was inspired by our project here in Colorado. Pam Bosch is working on remodeling her whole house, but she started with a tiny, tiny hemp house. We're going to get a little bit more into the details of the construction of it. The hemp lime thermal wall system is a recipe of the inner part of the hemp stock mixed with a lime-based binder. So you probably have them in your, you know, lime in your stores. You can use a construction lime, but you can use an agricultural lime as well. And then that's mixed with water and a more hydraulic binder to make it set a little bit quicker. And then we build a form system onto the framing. So it's not a replacement for concrete, but it is a replacement for the drywall, the insulation, the exterior boarding, the house wrap, the caulk, the siding, the paint, all in one thermal wall system. You can build a post and beam or a stick frame, or a metal frame building, and then you cast that material in like you would slip form concrete. So we have about 2 inches, attaches on either side of the wall, we pour that material into the wall cavity, and then we move up another 2 feet. So it completely surrounds all of the wood in between, the joist and things like that. There's an effect with house building known as thermal bridging. That's where more heat escapes where a 2x4 is than where the piece of insulation is. Piece of insulation for a 2x6 wall is about an R19. A 2x6 piece of lumber is about an R2.4. So everywhere where you've got a framing member, you have heat escape there quicker than it will where the insulation is. And because our system actually surrounds the framing, it essentially eliminates that thermal bridging issue. We can use it for our floors instead of a slab on grade, but not the footer, not the actual foundation. And we can use it for the walls and also overhead for our insulative infill. Now for you technical guys and your engineers, we have information available from Europe, tests and things like that that we can use to convince our building departments that this is a newer and better way to build. This slide shows you in some pretty simple terms why a hemp home is more comfortable. It's able to take in a little bit of moisture, and with that it takes latent heat. And then it gives it off at a quicker rate than, say, what concrete would. But concrete stores energy also. It's just not very good at giving it back to you. And that's why concrete structures always feel a little bit cold and clammy, where a hemp home will maintain a more constant temperature and feel more comfortable. And this is the microscopic view of what the piece of the hemp herd looks like that we use and how it actually is able to take that water vapor in and store the heat inside of the xylem of the cell wall. This industrial hemp movement is pretty amazing. Now, we're here in Colorado, so we're you know, maybe a little ahead of a lot of the nation. We were the first ones to legalize industrial hemp. We were also the first to legalize recreational cannabis, and that both happened on Amendment 64. Industrial hemp got tacked on at the last minute to the recreational marijuana bill. However, a couple of years before that, we actually legalized industrial hemp through the legislative part of the system for phytoremediation. Industrial hemp is very good at pulling things from the soil. So there was a Tex project down at Rocky Flats where there was a lot of heavy metal contamination, and they tested it to see how well that the industrial hemp would pull up the heavy metals out of the polluted soil. And they got that idea from Chernobyl, where they did it on a large level. The federal government is wanting more and more bio-based, agricultural-based products, and there's now a bio-preferred program where if you have your bio-preferred certification, you get first look from anything purchased from the federal government. And industrial hemp has a really good, solves a lot of those problems. When I went over to Poland, they asked me to talk a little bit about how well it did on lead, and their counterpart is bream. So I did a little bit of research, and when you look at the lead checklist, industrial hemp does very well on this checklist. But a lot of the things to get lead is really points that you would accrue just by how you face your house, what type of grading you have, what type of heating and ventilation system that you have. And with the materials and the engineering that's available nowadays, it's easier and easier to get LEED certification. Here's a larger commercial structure that was built in Europe, a mall, where it achieved the highest rating of BREEAM status, which is the green way to build in Europe. Here's another one, passive house. These are all kind of checklist ways to build more sustainable housing. And passive house, I believe, was a German system that's similar to the other ones, but had some specifics as far as heat recovery goes. The first hemp house I built was a tiny hemp house up north, and we were going to try to get you on that tour, but it proved to be a little bit too much for the schedule, so we're going to have some pictures of them here. But the tiny house movement is really a growing trend. We had a tiny house jamboree in Colorado Springs, and this was last year's attendance. This year is expected to be about 60,000 attendees there looking at the tiny houses. And most of theirs are on wheels, and with our hemp lime system, we actually build them permanent. However, my organization is working on some other building materials that we'll make out of industrial hemp that's not the hemp lime system. It's fun to get creative with the tiny houses. I think that's a lot of its allure. You can do some really fun things, and this is actually, I think it is a boat on a trailer that they just made into a little tiny house. Just like any other house, it starts with your foundation, and there are certain companies, if you're going to build a tiny house on wheels, you want to buy one of their trailers that's specifically designed to hold your tiny house. They go to great lengths to make sure that it's engineered correctly for you to go ahead and build on top of it. It's not the same as building a traditional house. You got to kind of throw your carpentry skills out the door, and you got to build things more like automobiles and RVs are built, with Loctite and ways that the screws don't back out and all kinds of things like that, in order to get them to handle the road vibration as you go down the road. Or if you don't want to do that, you just build one on the water and you got yourself a tiny house boat. And in fact, a lot of the tiny house technology comes from RVs and boats. They make cabinetry and appliances and all that that kind of thing. Okay, now see, here's a tiny hemp house. And we started with a very simple post and beam frame. Myself and my the guy that I've been framing houses with for over 30 years, we about 2 days we had it ready to put the hemp into. And so that's what that is on the left. And on the right is the hemp tiny house through the hemp casting and the first scratch layer of plaster. It's really not too hard. We do 3 and 5 day workshops showing people and actually getting them on site. And we have all kinds of different people from the building industry, young people wanting to learn how this hempcrete system works. It's pretty simple. We have 2 different types of lime, the industrial hemp stock and water, and we mix that up, and it's a fairly simple recipe, not complicated at all. There's other ways you can frame it. The post and beam is the center, what we know as a stick frame on the left, and then a commercial steel building on the right. The only thing with the steel is you want to make sure that you've got everything primed correctly before you cast the hemp inside of it. Here's just some examples of some of the workshops. We almost always sell out of our workshops, whether they're in Colorado or Pennsylvania, was down here, and then New Mexico, Grand Rapids, Michigan, Lincoln, Nebraska. I've been all over Canada. So we have on the job site, when we're teaching people how to build, we might have about 25 people, and we break out into teams, and there's a shuttering crew or the form work, and there's a mixing crew, and there's a casting crew or a tamping crew, and then later on we come back and apply the plaster. We do a lot of things with our small workshops by hand. I've got some human-powered mixing, like my bicycle-powered mixer here. It mixes up the hempcrete. And then the one on the right is one of our most favorite because the people actually get to get their hands inside of it and feel what the consistency of the mix is. And there's different ways that we can deliver it in buckets. If you're going to build a 3-story house, you're going to want to really tool up and have some good lifts and things like that, and better mixers than my human-powered mixers as well. Here's the tiny hemp house up there in Berthoud, a little bit more finished with some artwork plaster that we've done both in the inside and outside. And down on the, if you were going to be here a little longer, you could have gone to the hemp spa over there in Longmont and got some nice treatments using some hemp-derived lotions and things like that. And you could see where I've taken the hemp wall system and I've cast it with some pretty colors. So you can build a tiny house, or you can build a commercial structure about the size of a football field using this technology. And these are a couple of examples in Europe. And you know, the one on the left is a brewery storage and distribution center, and the one on the right is a wine storage and distribution center. They were particularly interested in this technology because of the way it maintains a constant air temperature. And so they save literally hundreds of thousands of dollars a year because their wine and their beer likes to be kept at a constant year-round temperature. And these systems perform very well for them. More and more states are starting to legalize and grow industrial hemp. We're finally figuring out that it is not psychoactive and it's completely different than recreational cannabis. And there's really good uses, and they can bring a lot of economy back to our farms and things like that. So some of the things we're working on is, of course, hempcrete, but also hemp plywoods and hemp strand boards, hemp insulation. We have some friends that are working on the finishes and things like that. I should have brought my hemp. I have a hemp plastic pen that was made out of hemp products. And so if you're going to legalize hemp in your state, you need a way to kind of jumpstart it, and building materials is a good way to do that. I get asked a lot by people, well, what about the building department? Are they going to approve it? And, well, yes and no. No, if you go in there, can I borrow your napkin? If you go in there and you have your plan drawn on this little napkin, and you go in there and you say, I want to build this house out of marijuana, or cannabis, technically that's true. Hemp and, you know, hemp is cannabis and marijuana. They're the same plant, they're just bred for different purposes. So technically if I went in and said I was gonna build a house out of cannabis, that would be true. But that's not how I wanna start off. I start off very professional, I dress nice, I have my educated engineer with me, and I go in with my plan already drawn. This is the same for any natural building product that you would use. Very professional, educated, knowing what you're talking about and having good professionals on your side. And you go into the building department after you've got all their checklist ready, and then you tell them that you want to build a structure that is going to be using an agricultural-based material that they've built thousands of in Europe, and we have tests and things like that, and my engineer has put that into the architectural details of the plan so you know exactly what we're working with here. And it does meet or exceed the intent of your code. And if you're professional like that and you explain it to them, you don't even really have to say industrial hemp. At some point in time, they will ask you what plant material that you're using, especially here in Colorado, and then you tell them it's industrial hemp. Now, more and more, I mean, I'm in my 50s, a lot of the guys running the building departments are my age, and we grew up in the 70s, so we were pretty familiar with all this and a little bit more friendly to the uses of industrial hemp. This is the specific thing that you want to point out to the building department, because this is a Larimer County, excerpted from the Larimer County code book, but the number R104.11, it's in there somewhere, R104 something, where they talk about alternative materials. And so in their book, they say that that these materials shall be approved where the building official finds that the proposed design is satisfactory and meets the intent of the provisions of this code. And it's easier and easier for us with our information and our science to prove that it meets and it exceeds the provisions of their code. It's important to our nation. It was back in the early 1700s, and it cost us more and more to dig deeper for our resources. It cost us more and more to cut the trees and process the trees. We should still use lumber. I'm a carpenter, I'm a lumber guy, but we shouldn't be using paper for everything that we, wood trees for everything that we can grow in the farmer's field. The industrial hemp plant has a really long tap root, so it's a great rotational crop. That's why farmers down in Kentucky and North Carolina, where they've lost most all of their tobacco business, they're now getting in industrial hemp. I think we're up to close to 30 states now that allow the growing of industrial hemp. I do teach workshops. Here's a couple of flyers that kind of explains to you what we do as an educational program that's global. Here's a picture of my mentor, Steve Allen from Ireland, and the book that he authored. So I took his class for 3 days and bought his book, and I was off and running, educating other people and building structures. Now, earlier I showed you the mayor of Asheville's home, but this home here was actually the first American hemp home built by a man named Alex Whiteplume up on the Pine Ridge Reservation. And in 2000, he attempted to grow industrial hemp, and the DEA came in and chopped it all down. They came back in 2002 and did it again, and he's still not allowed to grow industrial hemp. He's been working real hard with the attorneys and the district attorney and everything, and he thinks he's gonna be able to bring industrial hemp back to the reservation next year. There's all kinds of things going on around the globe. We talked about Sergey from the Ukraine. After the Nepal earthquake, my friend Shaw is rebuilding a hospital using industrial hemp where it's always grown in Nepal, so he already has a supply of it. He just has to get it processed. The same thing down in a Moroccan village where cannabis grows just wild, and she was able to turn the stalks into something more useful, like her cannabricks that she makes out of Spain. And that particular lady there, she has some unique technology. The cannabricks are what you see there, and then she's got a looser infill insulation also. And then they have some wall panels and things like that that you could source them out of Spain, but they get kind of expensive to bring them over on the boat. here just in the last couple years, these are some of the places that I've had the opportunity to speak, and I now can add the Northwest Lumber Association onto my list, and pretty soon I'm going to have to delete some of them or get a bigger page. These are just some of the, you're here at the 45-minute Tiny Hemp House keynote here, and one of our popular ones is an 8-hour workshop where I travel around the world and do that one, and mostly here in Colorado. I do the 3-day workshop, and we also can show you how to frame a workshop. And if you have any questions or anything like that after tonight, feel free to contact me at tinyhemphouses.com. And here's the final picture of us educating some Nebraska legislators that were considering industrial hemp for their state. And we're out in the field showing them different things that we can do. That's the end of my story, and I'll open it up to questions if you guys have any.
So basically what you're doing then is pouring walls made of hemp material?
Yes. Yes, but we can't build it like you do a concrete form where you go all the way up. You got to do it about 2 feet at a time.
Okay.
More like what's known as a slip form, where you would put concrete in and then a whole bunch of rocks, and then you move that up, and then you pour in your next system, and you move that up again.
So that replaces studs and stuff, or?
No, if you were doing full concrete, you would, but we're going more for comfort than we are strength.
Okay.
And so we still use a traditional framework. However, you can use less lumber. You don't need as many, you don't need to be 16 inches on center. You can be 2 foot, or with post and beam, you can be up to four feet, depending on the engineering of your beams.
What would the cost of a hemp home be versus a traditional?
Well, right now we still import most of it from Europe. And we don't quite have that many crews trained, so there are some increased cost, but it wouldn't be any different. It's somewhere in between the cheapest way that you can build a house, you know, the cheapest way you can throw them up. We've got all those going up, you know, by the hundreds around here. And then somebody decides they want to build a custom home, and most all custom homes nowadays take some consideration into energy efficiency or better performance. They may put geothermal heating systems in, solar panel heating, photovoltaic heat, extra insulation, extra styrofoam, or things like that, and we'll fall somewhere in that category of energy upgrades. And once we get more and more local product grown, we can hopefully we will be able to get that dollar price down to where it's not really anything, it's not significant more than anything else. However, it's a longer lasting luxury product, essentially. If you put, does anybody know how long photovoltaic, you've been in Colorado, you probably saw a lot of solar panel, a lot of those photovoltaic, that bluish, anybody know how long those last? Anybody know how much those cost? It's a lot. So my father-in-law has $56,000 worth of solar panels on his roof. Do you know how long they last? 25 years. Who's going to spend $56,000 in 25 years? Not too many people. The wealthy. But if they were on my house and it was time for me to replace them, I don't have that kind of money. So in 25 years, a lot of the photovoltaics, they're not going to be a part of our system anymore, and people won't be able to afford to replace them. Where if you invest in something like industrial hemp for your wall system, we're hoping they last, this technology may last 1,000 years.
Do you have anybody making hemp OSB as a commodity?
There is some hemp boarding that comes out of China primarily.
Nobody in the U.S.?
Nobody in the U.S., no. My company is working on the technology where we're you know, and we've got to get through a couple of stages of the testing before it can be certified to be used on the market, but we're in the research and development stage of that.
What's the strength?
OSB, it's got, you know, it sounds like you know, but it's got those 4-inch long strands, and they've got to be like an inch and a quarter wide or something for them to be one of those strands. Where hemp doesn't have all of what OSB can have, but it can make a good it can be a good replacement for a lot of the veneers and things like that, and still be used as that exterior boarding. Or it can be used all day long for particle boards that are much lighter weight than you know, the way we build a desk with a glue and sawdust. I don't know how they make that so darn heavy, but industrial hemp will be lighter for those purposes.
But the strength, is it better or worse?
Well, it not as good as OSB. You're still going to have some of those oriented strand boards because of the way, that's why they chip those, they make them 4 inches long and about an inch and a half wide. And we can't do that with industrial hemp. We can't get it that wide.
So how heavy is this, that mixture that you're making? When it dries out?
A lot lighter than concrete, but heavier than fiberglass insulation, so somewhere in between that. So it's not really suitable for a tiny house on wheels because of its weight, and the road vibration is hard on things. But you don't have to do any different or very little different engineering. Your engineer will help you and calculate the weights to figure out if you need a bigger beam. If you're going to put it overhead, you might need, you know, a little bigger beam to carry the extra weight that the hemp is over what fiberglass or cellulose would have been.
How do they process it? I mean,
hold on, let me make sure. Yeah, she didn't.
I just have one question. Okay, so you pour, you've got your wood frame, and you're basically pouring like you would concrete.
Yeah, kind of.
So
yeah.
Then what happens to like the traditional, your electrical and your plumbing and everything?
Yeah, and it's the same. You put your electrical and the plumbing in just like you. So that's one of the things I like about the system is a lot of the subs do exactly the same thing, with the exception of your your electrical. You would want to cover with a plastic conduit to protect it from the lime, and the building inspectors like that. Most of the plumbing isn't in your outside walls, but if it is, then you want to make sure you're using plumbing material that would resist the lime.
Sorry. In processing, you mean, do they come in and just cut it off next to the ground? Is that how they started?
Yeah, there's different parts of the industrial hemp plant that can be used. The seed oil is extremely valuable. It's known as a superfood, and that industry has been led primarily by Canada. And then so you take the tops of the plant off, which contain the seeds, and then you can use the stalk for either the fiber that's on the exterior that you make shirts out of, or the inner, which is more like a little wood chip on the center of it. So you would take the tops off, then you would take the stalk down to the ground. And in Canada, they waste most of the stalk. They just throw it right back into the soil or they burn it. And they don't do very much of it, but it has entirely good uses, and it's an extra way that farmers can add value to their acreage.
So when they break it down, is it still, just say it's a half inch round, I don't know how big it is, half inch round, and that's what they put in to the concrete, or do they break it down faster?
Yeah, even smaller. The little chip is made in. The stalk can be anywhere from, you know, about an inch around to up to 2 inches around. And then that's broken down into a small little piece. But it's not a very big wood chip. Some of it I've gotten, it's a little bit bigger, and about a half inch is about as big as I like it for the hemp lime construction. And then you might process it, if you're going to use it for different things, you might want it a little bigger or a little smaller. If you're making a particle board or a press board, you'd maybe want it in a fine powder to give it that nice smooth finish that we like to put our Formica on top of.
On average, how long is the piece then?
Pardon?
Is it, I know it's half inch, but how long is it then?
About that half to three quarter, and then it would be crushed rather than have that round. It's actually crushed down to where it's only a very small piece, essentially. Yeah, yeah.
What does the hemp work out to be in far as an R value in that same?
We recommend a 9-inch wall, and there's been some tests done in Europe that tells us that 9 is somewhat of a magic number. When you go less than 9, it you see some rapid deterioration in performance. If you go to 12, you don't really see all that much difference between 9 and 12. So that's what's recommended. And a 9-inch wall gets you about an R22. So that's a little bit thicker than your 2x6 wall, but that's the recommended system. So it's a little different. When we measure a piece of insulation, we measure its heat resistance just for the material. And the hemp wall system, because of that eliminating of the thermal bridging, performs much better than an R19 piece of insulation. And in Europe, they do have more of a comfort value, where all we do is measure that resistance. We don't look at the entire system. We just look at the piece of material itself.
So when you're saying 9 inches, so you build the wall either out of 2x4 or 2x6, and then your forming material is past that on both
yes.
sides, so that it completely
that's right.
covers the stud?
That's exactly right. Yeah, and then it so it eliminates the thermal bridging on the in the wall system, but also as carpenters, we know that it's in between floors where all that the rim joist and things comes together is where most of the heat loss in a house is, or the transition in between the top of the wall into the attic. That's where a lot of heat loss is up there during that, and the hemp completely encases all that, so you're essentially surrounded by it. Well, I really do appreciate you guys letting me talk and listening, and I appreciate your questions and your interest, and thank you very much. A lot of times this building inspector will say, oh, that's hempcrete, right? Yeah, I saw a video on that. It was in Habitat, or somebody up in New York was doing it. And didn't the mayor of Asheville, North Carolina build a house 10 years ago? Yes, he did. Didn't Hawaii, aren't they building that? Yes, they are. How about Europe? Yes, they are. And then you get them going and looking at the information that's online, and they'll come back, and what we're looking for is that then they're all in, they're behind you. Wow, that's the best system I've ever seen. And if they call you Mr., then, you know, Mr. Patter, then you know you've gotten to the, you know, then you've got some respect. And, you know, I dress very nice, you know, when I go into these places to, you know, I want to let them know that we're serious about this. We're not just building houses out of pot here. Now, that brings me to the point, you know, everybody says, well, can you smoke your house? And the answer is no, in fact, you can't hardly burn it. So I got my fire extinguisher, not because this will catch on fire, but just in case I catch the ground on fire or something. But did you guys know the flood came through here? That's why this is such a fine soil here. So there's really not that much other than the hay to catch on fire. So when they do a fire test, they do a couple of different things. One is a flame spread. So they spread the flame across the wall and see what happens. So think about how fires start in a home. We think that they burn from wildfires, but more fires are caused from inside of the house. Electrical, the carpet catches on fire, the couch catches on fire, or whatever. And then it's what catches other things on fire is what they try to stop. So that's what they're trying to do. So drywall is our fire barrier in our houses. So I like to test what I'm competing against. So I was doing this test here, and I'm about to do here. And I decided that I would try it on drywall because that's what our fire barrier is, right? So that seemed pretty logical. Don't try it though, because as soon as you put the flame on a piece of drywall, the paper burns almost immediately, and it puts off a black toxic smoke. And I breathed in a little bit, and I was, oh, it was nasty. And so our fire barrier actually has something that's extremely flammable that's on the outside. And then we go ahead and we put a chemical-based paint on there, and it burns. Now, what do they tell you back in school? What kills you in a fire? It's the smoke. And it doesn't help any that that smoke is toxic. So maybe it's not so much even the smoke. It's a toxic smoke. And in fact, if you want to check out a good documentary, it's called Toxic Hot Seat. And that's about the San Francisco firefighters. They wanted to find out why their brothers that were saving people, why they were dying, why they were getting cancer after being on the force for even 2 and 3 years. They figured out that it was the fire-resistant chemicals that were put in the furniture. They figured out that the fire-retardant chemicals did nothing to stop the couches from burning, but when they did burn, they put off toxic black smoke that wasn't filterable through the firefighters' protective gear. And so they were able to get legislation enacted in the state of California that these fire retardant chemicals are no longer required to be put in the furniture. But they still put them in there. There's no restriction as far as whether or not they can put them in there, but they made a big milestone. They also determined that sudden infant death syndrome, a high percentage of the time, had nothing more to do than the fire retardant chemicals in the crib mat. When the baby was face down on the mat, got a toxic inhalation of chemical fumes, and that's what killed the baby. I can't remember what percentage of the time it was, but so you see a little bit of smoke coming back here, but that's more from the steam from the propane. You can see it gets red. It actually absorbs the heat enough, but once I take that off, you see the red immediately it goes away. So this is non-combustible. It doesn't catch on fire and then catch other things on fire. I could hold it on there longer, but now eventually, if I do hold it on there long enough, this is a pretty hot, very concentrated flame on one particular spot. And that'll stay warm for a while. I don't want to touch it right now. You can see this is cooling off, and that it deteriorates the material, but it doesn't catch it on fire. And it's still a little bit warm in there, but cooling off fairly quickly. But definitely not starting anything else on fire. So I started mixing up a little bit here. We're just going to make up a small batch of hemp here today. We're going to make some bricks. What I got in here so far is only hydrated lime. And it's not even the specialized lime that you get at Home Depot. This is more of an agricultural product. It's like half the price of the builder's lime. And so I mix that up first, and then this is actually metakaolin. Gives me a faster hydraulic set. Just the lime actually stays a little bit too soft. Then I mix that together in a slurry, and it's nothing like concrete or thin set or anything. It's more like a soup. And it mixes pretty easy. And we got bigger mixers to work with than the little hand thing here. That's a pretty easy part of the step, and it's a little easier to see in the tray here how it works. So then I put the hemp in the tray, spread it out a little bit. Actually, I kind of think I might need a little more hemp. So overdid it on the water, maybe. So sometimes when I do these workshops, I get a little mixed up on my recipe. But I've done enough of it that I can look at this here and know, I think I added double the water that I was expecting. So I'm going to put it's about whatever your powdered binder is, it's about equal amount that you end up with water there. And I got so I added a little bit more of that. That looks better. And since I did that, I'm probably going to need a little more hemp. For the, this is my doing these little bricks is a little different recipe than the wall system, just because they do, I found they hold together a little bit. So rather than four parts of hemp, I use about three parts to hemp when I'm making the bricks. But when I make the wall system, it's about 4-to-1 binder to hemp. And there's some different types of binder I have here. This is a NHL5. It comes out of France. It's a little expensive to bring the lime from France, so that's why we've got some other things like the Meta-KLN, which comes from Canada, and actually we use a little bit less. And we can get that in different places too. All right, so now I know I'm a little more like it, like I like it. So in our workshops, we actually work on a tiny house, and we build a 10x12. Usually have it framed up, and then we might have anywhere from 20. I think we had maybe 32. Sunny over here, she was in a class we had up in Fort Collins. Our last 2-day class was $299, and sometimes we're going to be having some more extended ones up to 5 days. I haven't really decided on those how much yet. But. Well, we're getting more and more hemp coming from Colorado, and it's getting better and better as far as its quality and the way that it's processed. Most of the lime comes from Colorado, just right up north. I go up to La Porte, and it's mined in either Livermore or South Dakota, but that company, they work up and down that corridor, essentially. So pretty soon we'll be able to get essentially all of it. Now, it's not like a normal concrete mixer where the barrel turns. That doesn't work very well. It ends up making it into little hemp balls, essentially, instead of how we like it. So the mixer that we like is a round one, and it's got the barrel stays still, and then the paddles turn inside of there so that it causes kind of this thing instead of just letting it turn over on top of itself. And so when we mix it by hand, we learn that it works better to kind of, this is kind of how the paddles turn inside of the mixer. And then, the main thing is just to get the plant material coated, and then the hemp actually kind of takes the mixture and sucks some of it into it. And that's what gives it its capability to bind. And so, you know, that's...
Do you want me to put some of these boxes together?
Yes, please. Thank you. Good call on that. Set out a little, make it a little more moist. And after being at my class, the first morning, we usually like to do a slideshow on the Friday night, and that gets all the questions, everybody understands the theory behind it and all that stuff. And then on Saturday morning, we're ready to go to work. And I usually have somebody that's already been at one of my classes, and we put them on the mixer. The mixer is the highest paid position on the job. Anybody know why? Two reasons. One, it's important that the right stuff gets in the mixer. And it's easy to kind of get a little too much or a little too much more, and you want to be consistent. That's the main thing. So that mixer guy maintains that consistency throughout the day. But the other reason is it's hard, messy, dirty work, you know.
It's kind of like baking. You want to take into the ratios into account and the timing.
So you see, there's nothing dripping off of it, but it'll hold together pretty much immediately in a snowball. When I drop it, it falls apart, okay? That's pretty much that little snowball test. If it holds together, when I pack it into that snowball, I know that it's going to hold up good enough so that I can move my shutters right away. Now, you want to be careful, and if you do take one of these bricks, now don't be dissing on hempcrete because you can break the brick tomorrow because it takes a little while for it to set up. And so don't hand it to your strong friends, that's what I say, because they'll grab it. These were made yesterday, okay? And they're soft, they're not completely just yesterday, but you can already tell they're hardening and up fairly good already, but I could break this easy, you know, it's pretty soft, essentially. Now, these, however, this was actually a little thicker mix, but, you know, that's been, I don't know when I did that, months ago, but that, you know, that's good and hard. And this one is a little different recipe.
How long does it take to completely harden?
In Colorado here, not all that long. I mean, you go back in a few days after your the bricks actually take a little longer than the house. You go back in a few days and you can, you know, you're knocking on it and it's hard, pretty hard. But for all the moisture, before you want to put a finish on the interior and the exterior, you should wait probably 2 weeks, just depending on the climate. If it's in the spring and heavy rains and things, you might want to test it to make sure that you've got your evaporation of the water in the center of your wall before you start putting your second layer. You can put one side on almost right away as soon as it's hard enough to accept the plaster.
Okay.